Abraham Laboriel.
My pleasure.
Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Mark, for inviting me.
Now, here we are in the home of, you've been called the king of the bass. What does that mean? How does one get to be called the king of the bass guitar?
Well, I've been called many things. The reality is that I love music with all my heart. And since 1976 that I've been in Los Angeles up until now, I've been invited to participate in more than 3,000 recording sessions of all different types. And I started to play bass in Berkeley in 1971. And since that time, I just never stopped. Never stopped ever. So people are used to seeing my name and hearing me. And I have a style that is left of center. So people recognize it, you know.
Who are some of the artists that we'd be familiar with that you've played in their, on their records?
Well, just about everybody. I've done albums with Al Jarreau. I've done albums with Lee Ritenour, Larry Carlton, Henry Mancini, Michel Legrand, Joe Sample, Diana Ross, Stevie Wonder, Quincy Jones, Michael Jackson, Madonna, Barbara Streisand, you know, everybody.
What exactly is a session player? How would you describe a session player?
Primarily someone who is flexible. And in my case, besides being flexible, I have a style that is recognizable. So that when people want me to, they say, you know, Abraham, we want you to be yourself. Don't play what we wrote, play what you feel. Then I become a recognizable studio musician. Then when they really need me to be very disciplined and do exactly what they want and only what they want so that people will not know who's playing, I try very hard to do that. And so when they see that there is a will and an attitude that's flexible, pretty soon the word gets out that there is a guy that you can use, because if you want that, he can do that, and if you want this, he can also do that. Whereas many people, some of the famous bass players in town will say to the producers, if it is a ballad, don't call me. I do not play ballads. Or if it is difficult, send it to me way in advance so that I can practice it, and then I'll tell you when I'm ready. So if you start putting that many requirements before people are allowed to call you, then you become a specialist. And that's not the same as a studio musician. That every day we do different things.
Yeah. What would be the biggest hit song, hit pop song that you've ever played on?
Wow. I haven't put together my career from that perspective. I know that one of the very important songs that I did was with Lionel Richie, All Night Long, which was just for the Olympics. I've done Coca-Cola commercials and, you know, Ford commercials, Honda commercials that have been used all over the world. And I played definitely with some of the most successful people in the world. I think that one of the records that really sold a lot was the first record that I did with Julio Iglesias in 1983, which sold something like $25 million copies all over the world, because he did it in 8 languages. But I haven't, you know, that's a great question. I'm going to try to study my curriculum and see which ones are the ones that have sold the most.
You mentioned Michael Jackson and Madonna. When they call you, how does that happen? Can you take us through the process of them calling you and then you're playing?
Okay, they all have producers. And the producer, after they get together with the artist and arrange the song, then they says, you know, who do you think we should cast to be part of the rhythm section? And so at the time, Madonna was working with the same guy that did Like a Virgin, Pat Leonard, and so he hired Carlos Vega and I to do this particular record. And we came, and then she came after we had done the tracks and loved them. So she says, I have nothing to change or to, no comments. You did great. Thank you very much.
So you've already played, and then you meet them.
Right. In the case of Michael Jackson, Bruce Swedeen was producing this particular song together with David Page, the pianist, who was the arranger. And they had already done a sequencer version of it, you know, with machines. And they felt that they really needed personality, so they asked me to come and add the personality. And it was really special. So basically, they just have meetings, and then they start talking about what specific thing they would like to see happen to their song. And then availability, sometimes they call and we are not available, and they have to go on to somebody else. And then if they are still not satisfied, then they call back, and then they start comparing and like that. So it's beautiful because we all participate in the process as equals.
And you also have a career as a with a group. You play dates, live dates.
Mm-hmm.
How is that different from the session work, and tell us about that?
Well, there's a famous musician in Los Angeles who helped me to understand that concept, or at least I like the way he articulates it. He says, when you make a record, think of a funnel, and when you are making a record, you are in the big end of the funnel. So you have to make your sound and your concept very, very small so that it fits in the tape and it doesn't interfere with all the other people that are going to participate on the record. But when you play live, you are in the small side of the funnel. So you have to exaggerate everything to communicate to all the people out there. And both provide a wonderful sense of balance. Another great musician said that when he would do only film work, his sight reading ability would improve tremendously, but his ability to be creative would start getting dormant. And when he did records, his creativity would improve, but then his eye reading would fall apart. So he says balance and variety, I think, is the right address. You know. So I'm really blessed that I get invited to do films, and I get invited to do records and jingles and to play live.
You know. You play live, would you say, more in the US, Europe, or Japan? How does it balance out?
More overseas, but when I play things that are with complete freedom and abandon, it's usually in small clubs in the United States. You know, then when we go overseas, it's a little bit more structured. But one of the things that distinguishes me is that within the structure and within the discipline, I have a tendency to always choose spontaneity first.
That's a problem?
Well, people don't quite know how long before I'm going to start doing something out of the ordinary.
Take us back to your early years. You grew up in Mexico?
Born and raised in Mexico.
Tell us about that.
Well, my parents come from Honduras, Central America. I have an album called Gidum, and that's a word that my father invented. And we belong to a people called the Garifuna people, which in its own language, it means the Carib.
From Africa originally?
Originally from West Africa, and then they came in a ship that sank outside the islands of St. Vincent in front of Venezuela. So this particular group of people were never enslaved, and they survived, swam ashore, and they created their own language. They combined with the Arawak Indians, and then they populated all the Caribbean. And so we were the only people from that culture living in Mexico. And I was born and raised there. I didn't leave the country until I was 21 years old. So I am Mexican, and when I listen to mariachis, I understand and I start screaming, you know. But my brother, who's 5 years older than me, was the lead singer of the most important rock band in Mexico. So they won many awards. And all the American publishing companies were sending him material to consider translating into Spanish to record. And so that way I started to become acquainted with American music, and it stole my heart completely. So everything that was American in style or in sound, whether it was country or rhythm and blues or jazz. I loved it. So when I was 10 years old, I was playing along with the records and learning all these different styles. And I think that's part of the reason why I became so flexible. Yeah.
When did you start playing music?
Well, my father started to teach me guitar when I was 6 years old. Then I quit when I was 8. And then when my brother joined the rock band at age 10, I started to play by ear with records. And then when I was 21, I left Mexico and I came to the United States just to go to school in Boston and Berkeley.
It's a hard school to get into, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Mostly because it is a school where people go to train to become professional musicians. So they, at the time when I was going, it was 60% pop music and 40% classical. And the reason why they did it that way is because they knew that if we want to make a living as a professional musician, popular music was more lucrative and would open more doors than to be strictly trained classically. So,
were there any people you went to school with who went on to achieve success?
Yes, mostly jazz musicians. And there's one in particular who was my roommate. We lived in his house in New Jersey for 2 years during the summer times. And his name is Alan Silvestri, who has become one of the most important film composers of all time. And then Joey Lovano, saxophone player, John Scofield, guitar player, and Ricardo Silveira went after I graduated, and Alan Broadbent graduated the year I started, and Alan Broadbent has become like one of the major jazz pianists and arrangers here in Los Angeles. I coincided a little bit with George Mraz, great bass player from Czechoslovakia, and Joe Samuel from Weather Report fame. So, a lot of wonderful people. You know.
When you're on tour, what are the fans like in Japan? How are they different than maybe European or American fans?
Well, the people in the United States are very unpredictable. The people in the United States, their attention span is very willful. You know, they don't try to figure out, do I like it or I don't like it or what's going on. They just choose that they're going to love it or not. The people in Europe are highly educated. They really have read your biography. They have studied your discography. They understand what line you are likely to play at a given time. And that's really impressive. No matter how young or how old they are, the European fans have done a lot of homework. And then the Japanese fans completely blow my mind because it is the only audience that listens to the whole fade out. So that as the music starts dying, and the musicians are bowing down, they wait until there's complete silence, and then they applaud. You know, so they, you know what I mean, their attention span is different. They listen deeply. One time I went with Johnny Mathis to Brazil, and every time we sang Misty, the audience would give him a standing ovation during the bridge. And when the song would end, they would not applaud. They would not respond. So that was a very unusual experience. And then when I asked, they said, well, we like the bridge. So audiences have personalities.
I read that while at Berkeley, you sort of developed a new technique in bass playing.
Yeah, it's a combination of because my first instrument was rhythm guitar, and my father had a very unusual style of playing with a full sound, and he taught me, and I saw him perform many times. So that is part of my heritage. Then in Berkeley, as I started to get involved with all the intellectual aspects of what music is and how it works, when I discovered that I could transfer from the bass, I mean from the guitar to the bass, a whole world just exploded right in front of me. And I was able to differentiate between when I'm playing by myself and create a fuller sound like my father would do, or whether I'm just part of the overall orchestra sound and then I play very clean and stick to the function of the bass player. So in one of my teaching videos, I always say to people that that if they feel that they want to be bass players, that it's really important that they know the difference between the role of being the bass player, which is an accompanist and a supporter, and then being the feature instrument in front. Because when you become the feature instrument in front, then the bass function has a tendency to suffer a little bit because nobody's taking care of the foundation.
So the bass is a supporting instrument, and it should be.
Yeah, it's the foundation. One of my teachers in Berkeley said, you know, you are the house. And if you are not paying attention, you're leaving all of your friends without shelter. So it's a beautiful way of thinking that if you don't play the role of being the bass player, then the other people have nothing from which to build, you know.
So these days, how do you divide your time up? What is an average day like for you?
It varies. How can I explain it? Whenever I have time off, I try to spend it working with musical ideas in my little home studio and to create songs either to be recorded by me or by other people. And then when I don't have the time off, sometimes I leave the house at 6:30 in the morning and come home at midnight. So a typical busy day would be a film call that begins at 8 in the morning, and then you finish, let's say, 8 to 11, 12 to 3, and then at 4 o'clock you go and do a recording session, and that's 4 to 7, and then 8 to 11, and then you come home.
Is there ever a record that you play on that, you know, it's you're just not really crazy about it, but you have to do your job and play the bass lines?
Only when the people that put it together did not do their homework, and they expect us as the sideman to not only do their homework, but basically come up with a whole idea. That's particularly painful because you know that that they are taking unfair advantage of our role as musicians to take their ideas and make them blossom, as opposed to actually having to come up with the ideas. And those kinds of people, because of the financial constraints of modern day, are diminishing fast. Because usually when that happens, to come up with one song sometimes may take 3 days instead of doing three songs in one day, you know. And even at that, if the people that they had cast are people that have a particular affinity of working together, then it could be a lot of fun to create the ideas. But it's always sad when you know that that they're taking advantage of our ideas and taking the credit as if they had invented them themselves.
When all the computers and drum machines came in and technology, were you ever afraid that maybe someday they won't need me, they'll just have computers, machines that'll do this?
There was a period of 6 months where work became almost impossible to find because everybody was trying to figure out how to use these machines. And then the great joy came when we all realized that the machines were part of the music world, but not the music world. So that now we are better off because we have one more color to use or to choose from, one more way of expressing music. But the fear that it can completely replace a person or a person's validity has pretty much been eliminated. Mostly because the listening audience has become more sophisticated so that they can tell when something is done carefully and with a lot of imagination and with a lot of love, and when something is done automatically and mechanically.
You're known as a real sort of a creative bass player. Where do you find the creativity within yourself? What's an inspiration?
Well, the word that I use primarily is spontaneous. And spontaneity for me has always been clearly related to freedom. And I became free when I gave my heart to the Lord, because basically what happens is that when you're a musician and you are available to everybody for whatever they need, there is a certain amount of pressure that says, man, how am I going to come up with everything that all these people need? They have expectations on what they want from me. But when you have given your heart to the Lord, you realize that the Lord is the one that's creative and that we are just instruments that he uses to communicate his love and his creativity. So the pressure of having to be creative disappeared, and then I became free. And then also because of the honesty in your relationship with people, if you try something like, you know, that really makes you happy and they don't like it, because there's an honest relationship, you can learn to respect the fact that, man, isn't this great? And they say, no, I don't like it. Okay, so I'll go back to this other thing. And there's an honest rapport.
Now, your son is playing now.
Yeah.
Talk about that. He's playing the drums?
Yes, he's a professional drummer. He graduated from Berkeley in 91.
Same school that you graduated?
Yeah, actually, 91, 92. Yeah, 5 years, 91. And he's been incredibly successful. His last year of school, he was able to do a tour of Europe with me. He was able to play three songs on my first solo album. And then he went on the road with Joe Sample. He played live with Al Jarreau, and he played with Diane Reeves. And then after that, he graduated. And he's become a very successful studio musician.
What is it like playing with your own flesh and blood on stage?
It is it's hard to describe, but one time when he was like 11 years old, we were having a sound check with Koinonia, and Bill Maxwell and Alex, to tease me, they started to play the rehearsal, and then they called my son, and they asked him to sit on the drums, and I had my eyes closed, and we finished the song, and then I turned around to say to Bill and to Alex that it sounded really good, and it was my son on drums, and they laughed. So it was an incredible experience, you know. I literally feel like I'm walking on clouds. Around the house, my son practices with headphones, and he puts on his favorite rock and roll music. So whenever I heard him at home practicing, it would be primarily rock and roll. But then when I started to work with him or see him work with different people in different styles, I was very impressed that somewhere somehow he understood how to do all these different things with all his heart, you know. So it's a wonderful thing to watch somebody that comes out of your own life contribute. And he's becoming highly in demand as a live musician and as a studio musician.
Now, you created a genre known as jazz fusion. What is that about, and how did that come to be?
Well, I was part of the new generation of musicians that made that style famous. And basically what happened is that when Herbie Hancock and Chick Corea were being hired to open for rock and roll acts, and nobody could hear them, they figured that they had to make a transition into being able to have enough equipment and enough sound systems so that the people in the audience could just feel the impact of their jazz as powerfully as they felt the rock and roll bands that were the headliners at the time. And so it became an idea of playing still jazz music and improvising in nature with melodies that are challenging, but through equipment that can be heard in large places. And then what used to be a very freestyle playing drums in the traditional jazz swing style became more of a funk or rock and roll or Latin approach. So that then you started to hear drummers and bass players and guitarists playing patterns on, while the melodic instruments would play free on top of these patterns. And because both styles had distinct roots, they call it fusion.
What do you like about music?
The way I define music is incredibly narrow and highly opinionated. To me, music is when a person forgets what are they listening to, what instrument it is or what song it is, and it just becomes an all-encompassing experience of beauty and joy. And very few people can do that all the time, but almost everybody does it from time to time. And I have been saying to people, man, music visited you in this moment, and then it visited you again here, and then it visited you. And it's great when music visits and stays.
Any advice for young, aspiring musicians?
Just the most important advice that I can give to anybody is to not be afraid of being honest. Because if they are honest, their friends in the music business will help them to discover what they can do best. If they pretend to be somebody else thinking that that's what everybody wants them to be, and then that keeps shifting depending on what they think is hot. Oh, now this is the hot thing. Oh, now this is a hot thing. Then they become disoriented, and the people that want to help them become nervous because they don't know at what point they are going to turn, you know, like a chameleon. And really just be honest and do it with their whole heart. If they feel very comfortable supporting other people and helping other people to sound good, most likely they have the vocation to be a bass player and enjoy being in a supportive and encouraging role. If they really want to be always in front and always be dominating and be the instrument that plays the melodies and does all the solos, then they need a bass player.
Thanks for joining us
My
today.
Pleasure. This is great. Wish you all the best.